New Vision Christian Center.
Survived this winter storm and everyone's safe and at home in their nice warm houses. We're going to bring church to you this morning. Amen. Let's all have a moment of prayer. We open the service. Father God, Lord, we just want to thank you, Lord God. Thank you for another day that you gave us. Lord, we ask that you come into this house, Lord. Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask that you protect those that are on their way, Lord God. Protect those that are at home, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Behold, bless ye the Lord, all these servants of the Lord, which by night stand in the house of the Lord, lift up in the sanctuary, and bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, amen. The Lord that made heaven and earth, bless ye all of Zion. We're going to do a little things a little different here this morning. We're going to ask for Minister Shanika Ford to come and give us a selection. Say amen as she comes.
Thank you. verse 1 through 3, and it says, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. So basically what I got out of that is, for the last 2 years, me and my family have been going through a whole lot of trauma, a whole lot of basically hell, and a whole lot of trials and tribulations. And just in this year, God just recently told me, after we have suffered, we're going to reign with the blessing that he has promised us. So I'm looking for the blessings. I'm looking for the promises. I'm looking for everything that the enemy tried to take from me, tried to steal from me, because I will bless the Lord at all times. And I did bless the Lord at all times. While I was going through sickness, I was blessing the Lord. While I was going through hell, I was blessing the Lord. While I was going through trauma, I was blessing the Lord. While I was going through surgery, I was blessing the Lord. While my family was torn upside down, I was blessing the Lord at all times. So I'm going to leave with you. No matter what you're going through, no matter the situation, no matter the outcome, the income, no matter what the devil tried to throw at you, no matter what the doctor says, you still bless the Lord at all times, and you still be faithful to God, even in your bad times. Bless the Lord.
Let's say amen for those words. Thank you,
Father, we thank you for your goodness, for your mercy, for your loving kindness. Thank you for how you watched over us and you kept us all these many years. You've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. Thank you for this technology that allows us to come to you over the airways, and for those that have the skills to use it. Thank you for these brave souls that have come out during a snowstorm to be in church today, for our musicians and deacons, ministers, deaconesses. God, you're good to us. I ask that you would touch that family of Sister Margie Marie Crow, who we just had her home going on yesterday. Touch that family, encourage their hearts, help them as only you can do. And God, look on all those that are sick. Look on Francis. Amen. Francis, as she, my grandson's mother, as she's in the hospital trying to recover, touch her right now. Touch Elder Ephraim Jesse. Touch his body, God, that he will be able to totally recover from the COVID that seems to continuously attack him. Lord, we thank you for all of the good that you've done for us and how you kept us until this hour. We certainly pray for our bishop and all of those officials, the newly appointed Sister Peterson, that everything they do will be successful. Touch our district missionary, amen, so that she will continue to get well, God, in Jesus' name. May God anoint these lips of clay. Let me say words of encouragement, something that will be of some value to your people on a day like this. Lord, we want to say thank you for the snow. Thank you for the rain. Even in the midst of it, there is good. We thank you for it. We thank you for our safety. We thank you for having a place to worship. We thank you, Lord. We ask that you would bless our leaders, bless our president. Amen. Give them the wisdom they need. Even bless President Trump. Touch his body. Touch his mind. All of those that are in high positions, we ask that you touch them and turn them back to you, because we know that's where the real answer is. In the name of Jesus now, God, give me what to do, what to say, and let me say it right, that you might be pleased with what we do. In Jesus' name. Touch every member of New Vision that's watching on the airways. All of those that are not of New Vision, that the doors of our church are open for you. We pray that you would consider us when you start thinking about a church home. In the name of Jesus. While you're yet standing, those that are in the room, amen, I'm going to come to you and get in your way and get out of your way. And first of all, I want to hold this book up. It's called Restored Faith. We have an author in our church, Sister Diane Hastings, who recently, all of you know about Ella Hastings, as he passed away from COVID about almost a year ago now. But she has written two books, and this is her second book, and it's called Restored Faith. It's a good read. You should take the time to read it. It's a good book. Amen. You can get this book, I think, on
Amazon.
Amen. Very good read. Good read. I'm excited that I have someone talented in our church, and that they're pursuing their gift. Amen. God bless you. God, thank you for my musician, Elisha, all the way from Falcon, Colorado. Spent the night just so he could be here to play for us today. God bless you. You may take your seats at this time. Amen. I'm very happy to be here with you all. I got up this morning and I was thinking, looked out the window and saw all that snow. And I said, it's good to be alive. Amen. Amen. It's good to be able to feel the snow. And it's good to be able to get up in the morning and come to church on your own strength. Amen. I'm going to talk to you all from the book of St. Matthew, the 18th chapter. I want to appreciate Deacon and Minister Ford. She sang that beautiful song. Actually, I called them this morning. I had to call her. She's one of my major advisors. And I said, well, should I cancel service? And she said, Deacon said, why don't we just go and have a virtual service? And I said, amen, that's good for me. We're going to talk to you today from the book of St. Matthew, the first chapter, beginning at the 18th verse. St. Matthew 1 and 18. And it reads like this. Now the birth of Jesus was on this wise. This is from the King James Version of the Bible. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. Somebody say, we needed a sacrifice.
We needed a sacrifice.
God always has a way to help his children. I've learned over the years to don't ever count God out. I had a funeral service, a homegoing service here yesterday, and every seat was filled with young men and women, and many of them never go to church. And so I believe we have a mission. Our mission is still fresh, to evangelize the city of Colorado Springs. Amen. The Bible lesson that we're getting today is so familiar. Everybody knows it, but sometimes maybe they don't know it. Sometimes you think people know something they don't know. Appreciate Brother Babies and all of those that are here. From St. Matthew 1:18-25, we needed a sacrifice. Imagine yourself. People sometimes just sort of ignore Joseph. They don't realize what a great man he was. But think about yourself in preparation for your wedding day. You're a man, you're a male, who's a part of a historical family. You can easily claim that you're in the lineage of kings and your family has been instrumental in history down through the years. You may or may not have participated in a prearranged marriage. You have claimed for your bride a young virgin untouched by the hands of a man, including yours. You have paid a dowry to her father, as was the custom of that day. You've been able to construct a headband, which was from part of the dowry, to form a circlet of coins, which would attach to your bride's headdress as a symbol. Your father-in-law, I want y'all to go with me. Your father-in-law has already assigned a portion of the dowry to give to his daughter as a wedding gift. You have escaped military service because of your premarital status. You've already registered with the state your intention of being married, and now a year-long engagement process has begun. And then the news hits you. Wow. This woman that you have looked forward to with such great joy to marry has definitely shown signs of fertility. She is with child. And the child ain't none of yours. Oh my goodness, the anguish that you got to be facing. After all, you watched her sew on her wedding gown. You didn't watch her do it. You heard her parents plan an elaborate ceremony. After all, you are Joseph. And you may one day write a part of history. You got a future, man. You somebody. You're from the lineage of the kings. It'd be easy to digest it if you knew she was an adulteress. If you knew, that would give you an automatic reason for calling the whole thing off. If she had been raped, the law would grant you a visa for this situation as well. After all, according to Jewish law, you've been a man since you was 13 years old. You've been trained in the law. You've been nurtured in the law. You've been taught, amen, to love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and all your mind. And yet, every time you look at her, as she complains about morning sickness, as her body goes through obvious changes, as her complexion changes, she don't move quite quick as she had been doing. Your fiance, Mary, has caused you to suffer like you never suffered before. You're not the real daddy, but people are going to say you the daddy. Somebody here in TV land, and even some of you in here, not that many, but you understand that sometimes you got to deal with problems that you didn't generate. Yeah. You did not order from the problems and pain side of the menu. Yeah. You didn't request a large order of tears and heartbreak. You didn't ask for a room on the dark side of life. You did not ask for troubles, heartaches, pains, tears, worry, doubt, issues, drama, and hopelessness with a large set of problems on the side. It's not your fault. Your children brought you trauma. Your husband rocked your world. Your wife blew your mind. Your supervisor rocked your nerves, racked your nerves. You didn't start the fire, but you're feeling the heated zephyrs of the wind blowing heat in your direction. You didn't start it, but seemed like you're the only one suffering. You now spent every working hour trying to figure out what to do. That sounds like me sometimes. But Matthew describes Joseph as being just. The Greek word for just is dikaios, which literally means just. He's a just man. It means that you're a righteous man. It means that you base your principles, your earthly actions, you base them on heavenly principles. You're just. You're a good guy. And the Bible has all kinds of descriptions for folk like you. God says that he sends rain on the just and the unjust. Sometimes I wonder why it seems like the guys that I need to help me might be drug dealers. They don't come to church, but every now and then they'll send an offering. They always have money, and I'm always broke. Jesus says, I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus says, whosoever receives a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. The just shall live by faith. You want to do the right thing. You've been trying to do the right thing ever since you knew what the right thing was. Yes, I can look at you and tell you want to do the right thing. But in order to do the right thing, Joseph, look at yourself. You spend every waking moment trying to figure out how you can fix this thing. Joseph, can I help you understand why you're trying to fix this particular thing? It's getting bigger by the moment. Every time you look at your spouse, every day seems like she gets a little bit bigger and a little bit bigger. That's how some problems are in life. While you're trying to fix a problem, the problem's getting bigger. While you're trying to fix the problem's getting louder, like little Sister Ford over there. While you're trying to fix the problem, it's getting more and more out of hand. I found out something about you, Joseph. You'll spend every waking hour trying to figure out how to fix the problem, but you haven't spent no time in prayer to allow the problem fixer to access your problem. That's one of the reasons we're starting a 3-day prayer revival here at our church starting on Wednesday. But before I jump on Joseph too hard, there are a lot of people that have become, amen, professional handymen, problem fixers, without the benefit of consecrated prayer. See, there are some things you need to put prayer on. Some problems you can't solve without prayer. Imagine what problems would be like without prayer. And James 5:2 would have been rewritten to say that Elijah was a man that was subject to passions just like we are. But it wouldn't rain. Job 42:10 says, it'll be rewritten without prayer. If Job did not pray for his friends, it would be wrote like this, and did not get twice as much as he had before, had he not prayed. Luke 22 would have been rewritten to say that Jesus took a walk with his disciples instead of praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. Without prayer, David would have lost his kingdom to Absalom. Without prayer, Jonah would have been fish food. Without prayer, Abraham would have stayed Abram. Without prayer, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would have been great servants in the house. Without prayer, Daniel would have been leftovers in the stadium. Without prayer, Paul and Silas would have been locked away in jail. Somebody hear me today somewhere. Your life would have been a wreck without prayer. You would have lost your mind a long time ago. You still be crying today without prayer. Somebody in this room and on the airways know that if it were not for prayer, you would be a nervous wreck. If it were not for prayer, you would think your problems were too great to be solved. You would look at your tests as a test instead of a prefix to a testimony. You would have gave up a long time ago. However, there is a time when all of us got to give away to the leadership of the Holy Spirit and understand that the battle is not mine, it belongs to the Lord. And Joseph spent his every waking hour trying to figure out, what is he going to do with this scandal? He knew he was innocent, but now the scandal was about to label his future wife scandalous. His family was going to be ruined. His daddy, his mama, they were going to look at him like he was stupid. He knew he was innocent, but he thought sin had come into the camp. See, sometimes you think you know something, but you don't know. But what happened to him is he went to sleep. Yeah, I said he went to sleep. How I know this? Because the word says the angel of the Lord came to him in a dream. How can you sleep now, boy? I'm so worried about my bills. It done took sleep away from me. My son is sick. I can't sleep. I'm so worried. Out of all of the time to go to sleep, the rumor mill is about to place Joseph's name and his family name in the whirlwind. Y'all know a rumor can wipe you out if you let it. You're about to receive a terrible review in the society column. You're about to see what real malice from people is all about. People, they go to hating on you, and you don't know what to do about it. Some of the same people who say they love you are going to be talking about you. Some of the same people who've shared meals with you about to make you the main course of their communications. But you've gone to sleep. But this is good news for Joseph, because you were so busy trying to work things out that you didn't give God a chance. You forgot about how to really get things done. So while you went to sleep, God went to work. While you were asleep, God was dictating a message to the angels. While Joseph was asleep, God was giving passports to the angel from heaven. While he was sleeping, God never slumbers, nor does he sleep. I don't care what your enemy is doing, God sees it. He went to sleep, but God opened up the recesses of his subconscious. He went to sleep, but God interrupted the sleeping pattern to deposit something into his soul. He went to sleep, but God set up an angel to talk with him. And while he was sleeping, his eyes were flickering. His body was flinching. You know that's what happened to you when you sleep and you're dreaming. Your arms are moving because now God has your attention. And you were not lying, amen, to wake up from the dream until you got through with it. Maybe that's your story. Maybe God is not allowing you to move from your perch or your position until he done got through with you. Maybe God has got you in a holding pattern because he's trying to get you to hold to his unchanging hand. Sometimes God got to put you to sleep. God got to set you down. God got to lock you up in prison. Put you on your sick bed so he can talk to you. Maybe he got your lockdown so he can get your attention. Maybe God, amen, has got you locked down so he can prove to you that you can't get up unless he picks you up. Yeah. Amen. God might have allowed you to lose your job so you could spend more time with him. Maybe God crippled you, slow you down so you could hear his voice. You got to hand it to Joseph. Somebody really need to hear this today. Don't let your problems destroy you. Go to sleep. I said something then. Don't let the devil tell that you're not going to make it. Go to sleep. Get you some rest. Don't let the devil tell you to take your life. Go to sleep so you can wake up. Don't let the devil tell you you're going to give up now. Get you some rest. Go to sleep and get up. Don't let the devil's problems rattle you so much until you can't think about what's real. What are you saying, Superintendent Ephraim? If I go to sleep, my problems are still there in the morning. My bills ain't gonna go away. Yeah, but I came about to tell you, we can endure it for a night. But joy comes in the morning. I hear Joseph, I'm looking at him in my mind, and the angel says, "You descendant of David, don't be afraid to follow through on your commitment to marry this woman. I know it looks bad. I know you want to quit. I know you want to go somewhere else. Well, what you think looks bad to others, it's only the Holy Ghost." That word "of" denotes that it was not started by Mary. Yeah, it was not started by her doctor's diagnosis. It was started by the Holy Ghost. He impregnated Mary, according to the Bible, by overshadowing her. It was started by him, and if God starts it, he gonna finish it. How many times have we looked at a situation that we was in, money done run out, somebody done disappointed me, messed up how I was feeling, muddled up the picture, muddled up the testimony, lost something that you didn't think you'd ever lose, and you didn't know what you were gonna do about it. You lost your job, but then you find out that God got another job for you. Amen. You've been the tail, but God's promoting you now, not only not to be the tail, but to be the head. You've been in the fields, but God's getting ready to bless you now in the cities and the field. You've been lied on, but God is preparing you for a better situation. How do I know God is in this thing? Look at the text. The angel of the Lord came to Joseph. The Greek word angelos, which denotes a messenger of the Lord, a servant of the Lord, one who functions as a messenger. But here's the good news. The angel didn't write the message. His job is to deliver the message. The message didn't get written on earth. It was written in heaven. The message wasn't powerful when the angel told it. It was powerful when it fell from the lips of God. When God gave the message, it was powerful. That's why every now and then a preacher preaches, amen, and you get to feeling good because it didn't come from him. It came through him from God. Somebody, amen, ought to be glad that God is in your business. There's some things you know, if it had not been for God, you'd have been wiped out. Everywhere you go, God is getting into your business. He got you on his mind. Don't let nobody tell you that God done forgot about you. He's proclaiming freedom for the captives. He's proclaiming great joy for the depressed. And he is in your business. Joseph was given some things from the Lord through an angel that a man can deliver. He was given information during he was sleeping. He was given confirmation while he was asleep of God's presence. He was given theology information concerning Mary. No matter how he might have felt, God assured him, "Don't worry, I got this." He was given ultrasound results without an x-ray. He was given a birth certificate without a delivery room. He was given a name to use without stressing over name to use. And the name that he was given was Jesus. The name in the Bible 975 times. That name that translates as Joshua and justice. That name that means he is the Son of God. The name Jesus means he is the Savior of mankind. That name means he is God incarnate. That name that means Jehovah is salvation. That name that heals the sick. That name that raises the dead. That name that feeds 5,000. That name that wipes all my fears away. That name that gives me hope in hopeless situations. That name that brought me out of a terrible pit. That name that never loses its power. That name that's higher than the mountains. That name that's cooler than the sea. That name is more precious than rubies and diamonds. That name that suggests that he's God that became man for me. That name that suggests that he's man who became a servant. That name that suggests that he is a servant who became my sacrifice. That name that suggests that he is a sacrifice that died on a Roman cross. And it suggests that he died on a Friday. And I said, I came by to tell you there is nobody like Jesus. That name that rang through the hills on a Friday night. That name that rang through the graveyard on Saturday night. And that name that rang through the heavenly on Sunday morning. I came by to tell you early. I said early Sunday morning. Death couldn't hold him. The grave couldn't keep him. Humanity couldn't understand him. Mary couldn't recognize him. But early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand. Yes, he's all right with me. I think I'm close now. I'm a little old now. 85 years is a little bit of a long time. I've been trying to do this for about 49 years now. I don't know when the bell's gonna ring for me, but I came by to tell you, Jesus, I said, Jesus, he's a diamond in the midst of dust. Jesus, he's a rainbow in the midst of a storm fire. Jesus, he's a jewel in the midst of junk. Jesus, he's hope in the midst of despair. Jesus, he's victory in the middle of disaster. I came by to tell you, can't nobody, nobody do you like the Lord. Can't nobody lift you when you're down. That's the Lord can do. When I'm hungry, he's my bread. When I'm weary, he's my rest. When I'm out, he'll bring me in. When I'm tired, he gives me comfort. When I'm hungry, he feeds me. He's my doctor. In the sick room, he's my lawyer. In the sick room, say yes, say yes. Ah, yes. Can't nobody, somebody say yes. I said, can't nobody do you like Jesus? Tell the Lord, yes. I made up my mind. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. Father, here I am, Lord. Yes, I said yes. Yes to your will. Yes to your way. Yes to your mind. Yes, Lord, when I'm down. Yes, Lord, when I'm sick. Yes, Lord. Can't nobody, Abba Masha, can't nobody do you like Jesus? Jesus, the leader of the valley. Jesus, my comfort keeper. Jesus, my backlaxer. Jesus, my way out of no way. Jesus, my friend in the time of trouble. Jesus. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Have your way. Thank you, Father. Baba Shaka. Hilabo Fandorobo. Lord, have your way. Have your way in my life. Have your way in my business.
way in my home. Have your way in the church.
You in radio land. Touch your cell phone. Touch your TV. Make contact with him now. Give God a clap offering. Give him a wave offering. Do something. Tell the Lord yes. Lord, have your way. I'm feeling it. I will bless the Lord at all times. Yes. And if you're looking for a child, do love Jesus. Here is one. You'll be looking for a child that do love Jesus. Oh, here is one. Oh, if you're looking for somebody, do love the Master. Here is one. Here is one. If you're looking for somebody, do love Jesus. Here is one. Oh, yes. I feel a runaround in here, but somebody say, Lord, I love you. Somebody say, Lord, have your way. Somebody say, Lord, here I am. Use me. Tell you, use me up. Use me in your service. Use me, Lord. Heal, Lord. Heal in this place. Heal in Jesus' name. Heal all over the world. Heal our country. Heal the churches. Save the unsaved. Claim the backslide. Touch and deliver. Thank you. Yes, Lord. Yes, to your will. Oh, yes, to your will. Yes, to your mind. Come on, move in. All over the world. Yes, Lord. Come on, progressive. Yes, Lord. Yes, to your will. Yes, to your mind. Yes, to your way. Made up my mind. Thank you. Eva. Thank you, Lord. Eva, hold on. My soul said yes. You ain't got nothing to do with how many folk in the room. God is able. Pick you up when you're down. Bring you out when you're locked down. Somebody tell the Lord. Yes, Lord. My soul said yes. Into a head spot. Ain't nobody like the Lord. He's able. bless you. Thank you, Lord. Save the unsaved. Touch that family that just lost their mother. Touch the bereaved all over the land. Touch right now. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray this prayer. Amen. Calling my deacons to come. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Say amen, somebody. Tell the Lord thank you. Tell the Lord thank you. Tell the Lord thank you. Tell the Lord thank you.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord.
Let's give a hand for our own superintendent. Amen for that message. It really touched my heart. Now at this time, we're asking for you all to stay safe. Please send your offerings through the links that are below. And keep in mind that we're all...
Amen. Clap your hands. Lines are clear and understanding. Father God, we thank you on today. God, we thank you for covering us this far, even through the snowstorm. God, we thank you for blocking all accidents, scenes and unseen. God, we ask you to look on us, protect us as we go to our various destinations. God, meet us at our places. Let this anointing that's in this place go with us to our houses, to where we got to go. God, let it linger. Let it rub off on someone that needs to know you, needs to be saved, need to come back to Christ, God. God, I ask you to look on us, God. Give us the desires to want to live for you, do right by you. In Jesus' name, amen.